Welcome to Wager Talk TV. I am Kelly Stewart, joined by Tony Mejia, one of the newest handicappers at Wager Talk, but he is absolutely kicking ass and taking names in less than 60 days. Tony has burst on to the Wager Talk scene, just killing the game. I have no words. I am so happy that you joined our family because you have done so well, Tony. So before we get into it, we're going to talk a little bit of basketball handicapping, particularly NBA today, and what your style is. But before that, can you kind of let your subscribers know what to expect when buying a package from you?
Sure, Kelly. Well, first of all, let me say I got to thank you for bringing me on in part to this Wager Talk family. We texted and when I left my old home. And again, like one thing that I want to convey, yeah, I'm new at Wager Talk, but I've been doing this well over a decade. I had a competitor. And the fact is that the way I do things, I think that there are a few people that do it my way, but for the most part, fairly unique. And it's high volume, tons of games, tons of picks, totals, spreads, obviously. Got some futures, although I'm not a big futures guy. That's a guessing game at the beginning of a season. But if there are 10 games on a card, I'll probably have an opinion on five of them, side or total. And NBA, I'll probably give you, side and total for every game. I have a system that was born at CBS, CBS Sportsline, back in the day in the early 2000s, where I had Mejia selections. It was a feature where I predicted the score of every NBA and Division I college basketball and college football game. And I never look at spreads. So, one thing I want to convey is, and I have a notebook filled with, numbers. Obviously, you can't really see them, but there's millions of notes and numbers on these things that I come to before I ever look at what the actual spread is. And then I look for discrepancies within those numbers, kind of investigate why there would be things that are different. And, the end all be all is the books probably know what they're doing a little more than I do in terms of if I see somebody that shouldn't be favored. I'm going to find out why the books are favoring them and probably end up finding a reason why that is the better option. So again, all my picks are researched impeccably. That's one thing you can take to the bank is I'm never going to steer you wrong in terms of giving you some team to back. And then you find out, as the game tips off that somebody is not going to be in the lineup.
That's awesome to hear. I know that you do your research. And the NBA was not something that I was a fan of for a long time as far as a betting perspective. Of course, you could watch NBA on Christmas and everybody wants to get involved, but I always lost money. It was so infuriating. So this year, I started doing some stuff with my other job at Bleacher Report, and I had to dive deep into the NBA, and I really started to find some of these angles, some of these betting trends, and particularly I got into the in-game scene where I really thrived. Now, I need some help trying to handicap this NBA season this year. Last year was different. It was in a bubble scenario, so there was kind of this neutral court of sorts, and you really found some great underdogs, which you know are my favorite. Can you kind of start to go in through your process on how you are going to approach this NBA season?
Well, this NBA season, Kelly, is going to be unique as it is, because while we're out of the bubble, from what I understand, they're going to send teams to a destination and have them play two games there in three nights. So again, another unique situation where we go to the cliche, well, it's 2020, you got to roll with the punches. Next year, I believe, at least for the first half of 2021, we're going to be saying the same thing and only putting 2021 instead of 2020. So it'll be a unique NBA environment. The old go-tos of second night of a back-to-back and all that has been mitigated anyway because through the CBA, players balked at that, playing four games in five nights. You no longer see that. So it really does become a situation where you have to know the players, you have to know the coaches, you have to understand what they want to get accomplished, from the standpoint of exploiting mismatches, going deeper into their bench, when teams in the second quarter have such an advantage off the bench that it changes whatever the starters do, and you try to pinpoint mismatches. That's really it with the league, both college and pro, I think. Basketball is such a different animal than football. You really have to look at it from a very unique standpoint of, all right, what does Team A want to accomplish? What does Team B look to do to defend that? And how does that ultimately dictate the flow of a game? And then from that standpoint, you can kind of look at the number and see if the side is off or if the total is too low, and adjust accordingly.
Tony, one of my favorite things that I realized in the NBA is you can find some definite overreactions. If all of a sudden LeBron is out for the night, that line shoots 7 points in the other direction. What do you know? The team that it shot in the 7 points of their direction doesn't cover the new number. Maybe they covered the closing number or subsequent numbers in between, stuff like that. So what are you looking for in terms of a number perspective? How many points off of your numbers versus the market? Particularly, are you saying, okay, now this is worthy of a play?
Well, you have to understand how bookmakers do this as well. And I mean, you host a podcast with one, you're immersed in that. And it's wonderful to learn from you and the like, you know, who bring us these things, these insights that we haven't had, a decade ago. But aside from that, so we know now because of that how many points LeBron James is worth, because bookmakers are on Twitter. All right, well, Anthony Davis's absence is worth 3, 3.5, 4 points. Okay, great. Now it's my job to tell you, all right, well, Anthony Davis is going to be out of this lineup. That's going to be more small ball because Dennis Schroeder, newly imported, obviously, so we haven't seen it. But for this, the sake of this argument, Dennis Schroeder enters that lineup. We're probably going to see more ball pressure. Wes Matthews is probably going to get more minutes. That's another guy that they've just brought in. Marc Gasol is going to be in the mix more if there is no Anthony Davis. So LeBron James's second quarter, when he sits on the bench, is going to be now a situation where the Lakers are going to have to find somebody else, find another contribution. It's my job to say, okay, well, there's going to be a lull here, or there's going to be a situation where the Lakers can go on a run that nobody sees coming. And those 4 points that you took away with Anthony Davis, you're going to be able to make those up. And then that's where you see advantages as well, from that standpoint. And I'll bring it to you all year. The fact that I was able to do as well as I did outside the bubble before the pandemic hit, and then after March 11th, once the bubble came into play, I was dominant there too at my former home. So records are out there. I consider myself the best basketball handicapper on this planet. So we'll see if I can make that happen here at Wager Talk.
All right. Self-proclaimed best basketball handicapper on the planet. I cannot wait to have a kick-ass NBA season with you. NBA kicks off. It looks like Christmas Day. That's going to be an exciting one for everyone. Make sure you guys head over to wagertalk.com in the drop-down menu. Select Tony Mejia. You can get all of his basketball plays over there. And do not forget to give Tony a follow at Mejia De Niro on Twitter. Thank you for your time, Tony.
Thank you, Callie. Appreciate you.